the Lord. And thank God for another Lord's Day. We welcome you into the service via Facebook Live here at New Zion Baptist Church. And we come again on another Lord's Day to rejoice and be glad over the Lord and his goodness and what he's done for his people. We thank the Lord today as we come to you in this service, direct and live. We hope that you will enter into the worship experience with us wherever you are by singing, praying, and rejoicing as we continue in this hour. We want to also tell you that these services are edited and sent to the Faith Channel. That's Channel 19, the cable channel here in Louisville. And each Sunday at 8:30 a.m., on Mondays at 6:30 p.m., and on Wednesday at 11:30 p.m., you will see a repeat of one of the services that come to you on Sundays from this church and from this live worship. We praise God for that. We want to thank our volunteers and our staff for our 19th COVID-19 free food drive-through held on this past Saturday, a Thursday. Amen. 53 families or 58 families were blessed, and we praise God for his goodness. We want to thank the staff and volunteers, and we look forward to our 20th food giveaway on this coming Thursday as we rejoice in the Lord and his goodness. We also want to let you know that we are in a celebrative mood. This is our 48th year being commemorated this week as pastor of this church, and we thank the Lord for these 48 years. The official service will be held next Sunday, August the 25th at 12 noon. It will be via Facebook Live right here at New Zion, Louisville, KY. We also are continuing our support of this ministry through our online giving. New Zion, L-O-U-K-Y, is our new web address. The information is there. Cash App is available on the web page. And also, our mailing address is Post Office Box 11067, Louisville, Kentucky, 40251. As we enter into the worship service now, let us bow and pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples when they said, Lord, teach us to pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. 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 The church is singing, and we ask you to join our praises as they come with the melodies of our faith.
Thank you.
God for our praises here today, leading us in song. As we gather together, we always come seeking God's presence, God's power, and the peace of God. And so we invite you to join us now in the privilege of prayer. I'm going to ask Brother George Howard to come and lead us in prayer. And as he comes, there are melodies of faith that continue to bless us when we are preparing our hearts to pray. And surely we know there is a friend like Jesus. If you know him, if you know him, sing it out loud. There is a friend like Jesus. No other friend like him. Jesus knows all about our struggles, and he will guide us till the day is done. As Brother George comes, let's just for a moment prepare our hearts as we sing together. Jesus knows all about our struggles.
Opportunity, God, to call on your name in the midst of your temple, God. What a privilege, God, it is to come on one accord with your people, God, to just glorify your name as we reflect on your goodness and your mercy that still reigns even in the midst of isolation. God, we thank you, God, for being a God that's always present, that just doesn't show up in good times, but it's always there in bad times. But even in the mediocre times, God, you're still there with us, God. And that's enough, God. Just the fact there, God, that you will meet us wherever we are, God. Thank you for being that kind of God. So today, God, wherever we are, whether it be in our car, whether it be just sitting in front of the internet and screen, God, the fact that we are meeting on one accord, God, just to glorify your name, we count it a blessing to be in your midst, God. Lord, be with us today, God, as we uplift your name, God. But be with those, God, who do not know yet you in the pardon of their sins, God. Yes, God, we are standing up for justice as you would prepare us to. But most of all, we're standing up for your glory, God. So in the midst of us living right, God, someone may see what it really means to be a child of the Savior, God. Thank you, God, for this house, God, who continuously, God, leads its people in the path of righteousness, God. Thank you for Reverend A, God, for being an example for men and women, God, what it means to be a godly man. God, we ask you in the midst of this, God, that you be with our city, God, that you heal and restore, God. God, that you also be with those, God, who are trying to live the life and think that that's not enough, God. Remind them that that is our calling, God, to go ye therefore, and wherever we go, God, that we live such a life, God, that they too want to be saved, God. So in the midst of this, your people, God, be with us so that someone may too, God, come to meet you in the pardon of their sins, God. It's in Jesus' name that we claim all these things and count it done by saying amen. Amen. No, not Jesus knows.
Scripture gives us the words of the prophet Ezekiel. Ezekiel chapter 3, verses 14 through 17, the New International Version of the Bible reads thusly: The Spirit then lifted me up and took me away, and I went in bitterness and in the anger of my spirit. With the strong hand of the Lord on me, I came to the exiles who lived at Tel Aviv near the Kibar River. And there where they were living, I sat among them for 7 days, deeply distressed. At the end of the 7 days, the word of the Lord came to me. Son of man, I have made you a watchman for the people of Israel. So hear the word I speak and give them warning from me. May God bless us as we meditate on these words as the basis and foundation of the message today, as we shall share with you. But we want to say that you know, so that you will know as we know, Christ won't fail us. I have a comfort. Christ won't fail. In despair or trouble has come, I have a soul less whatever betide me. I am so glad that Christ won't fail us. Sometimes I don't know just how I make it, but this I know as onward I go. I have the joy of His affection. I am so glad that Christ won't fail us. Sometimes I'm right and sometimes I'm wrong, but he still loves me. I don't know why. Each day he guides me and walks beside me. I am so glad that Christ won't fail us. Oh yeah. He won't fail us. We fail him, but he never fails us, because there's no failure in our God. You can search the record through. He'll bless your neighbor and you too. There's no failure in him. And I'm glad that Christ won't fail us. Now let us return to the book of Ezekiel in the third chapter. And I read now from the third chapter and verse 15. And this is according to the New King James Version of the Bible. Just one verse where it says, "Then I came to the captives at Tel Aviv who dwelt by the river Kibar. And I sat where they sat, and remained there, astonished among them 7 days." The subject for this text today, the watchman sitting before standing. And as we prepare for the commemoration of our 48 years together here at New Zion, we are thankful to God for the history of this church, where only two pastors have served throughout all of its history. First 44 years, Reverend Dr. C.J. Cunningham was the pastor, and since 1972, it has been my privilege to serve. And this fourth Sunday marks my first Sunday here and my installation in 1972, the fourth Sunday in October. And yet this has been a very different season leading up to the pastor's 48th anniversary. This season has gone through a tumultuous change because our society has been wracked by the COVID-19 pandemic, which is a worldwide phenomenon. And though we thought that perhaps after a month or so we would be back to business as usual, we're still serving and challenged under the infectious rate of this pandemic. And we thank the Lord for those the Lord has guided to bring us closer to a solution. But also, we want to thank God for those who have been serving on the front lines, the essential workers. We ought not ever take it for granted or take it lightly. Neither should we let our guard down because of the very nature of this disease. It can, do you mind me saying it, sneak up on you. And therefore, we should be cautious, following all of the guidelines that we can. Hand washing, testing on a regular basis, mask wearing, just like you wear seat belts, and of course, keeping distance socially and physically. In the midst of the pandemic, however, we also found ourselves churned up by the outburst coming out of the tragedy of some police violence, not just here in Louisville, but in different other areas and cities of our nation. But Louisville has a unique place. It may be ground zero for the Black Lives Matter movement. And that's because of the terrible tragedy in the killing by the police of Breonna Taylor. The movement has continued now for more than 140 days. The protests have been unceasing. That's because chiefly that at the center of our city, in a city square that has become known as Injustice Square or Breonna Taylor Square, protests have continued day and night for 140 days, and then some. In some places, there are occasional protests that are planned here and there from time to time. In our own city, there has been a movement that will crop up here and crop up there, and just about every organization has wanted to be involved and has demonstrated in their own way, protested in their own style on occasions. But at the square, there have been individuals and groups who have met there every day in all kinds of weather. They have met there every night. Whether the cameras were on them, whether the media was covering them or not, they stayed there. They were roughed up by the police. Their possessions were plundered by city government officials, leaders, and yet they remained there. They have been able to stay there in spite of some individual and occasional issues that arise and incidents that arise by those who are not a part of the core group. And they have continued in spite of those unfortunate and embarrassing and in some cases tragic incidents. Today I want to share with you a little bit about my involvement, because my involvement has been an involvement that was in a very real way inspired by the prophet Ezekiel. Ezekiel, that prophet of the years when the Jews were being taken away from Jerusalem into captivity, the alien nation of Babylon. Ezekiel was one of the persons among 10,000 who were carried away captive in the year 597 BC. He was there as a prophet and as a priest to the children of Israel during their time of captivity. Ezekiel is best known for his dramatic description of some supernatural phenomena. He was a man who God gave visions And in our own tradition, we remember perhaps best the vision of him seeing the wheel in the middle of the wheel. And we sing a song in our tradition. Ezekiel saw the wheel way up in the middle of the air. And then we remember Ezekiel's vision of the valley full of dry bones. When the Lord sent him there to preach and to prophesy until that valley of dry bones was raised up alive as a mighty host and a great army. But when we come to this third chapter, we are invited to watch Ezekiel in the formative days of his ministry, the formative period of his ministry. He has certainly received a fantastic vision to let him know that God has called him for a special mission. He is to be the prophet of God among the children of Israel while they were in captivity in Babylon. Jeremiah, another one of the major prophets of the Old Testament, remains in Jerusalem and prophesies to the children of Israel who are remaining there in the period of their devastation. But Ezekiel travels by constraint with his fellow citizens to Babylon. And very early in his ministry, the vision comes to him to go and to prophesy to the children of Israel in Babylon. And we open this third chapter having read about his call. And then we see how Ezekiel was given the responsibility as a prophet to be the watchman to warn both the wicked and the righteous. He was to prophesy not only to the nation, but also to individuals. It is at this point that Ezekiel's approach becomes very non-traditional. He does not fit the profile of a prophet, a priest, who would serve God's people in the temple by his methodology. He is a traditional prophet and priest, but he's been given an understanding that his approach needs to be different. And so he says, as he entered into the city with his people, the period of their captivity, he says, first and foremost, I sat where they sat. I sat where they sat. There's always the expectation, there's always the tendency even among the clergy to feel that they ought to be heard. They ought to have a platform. They ought to have an audience so that the people could hear what they have to say. Because in fact, what we have to say is what God has to say. So we sometimes think. But if it's not grounded in the Word of God, if it has some other motivation, some other agenda, it may not be worth all that we want to proclaim it to be. But Ezekiel says, I sat where they sat. And he must have understood that people share with others in the time of their suffering. And when they share with their friends or their relatives or their fellow citizens the time of suffering, they can be overwhelmingly emotional. And even when you read this passage in the third chapter of Ezekiel, verse 15, that several translators translate that experience for Ezekiel in various ways. We already heard what the writer says In the New International Version, he says he was deeply distressed. In this text, we hear him saying he was overwhelmed. In other translations, he is stunned. And another one yet says he was shocked and silent. This is not the traditional role for which the clergy are known. And yet Ezekiel, though he was traditional in his prophetic and priestly ministry, was also visionary. And so when these words kept having influence, this was the approach that I carried to Injustice Square. I wanted to sit where they sat. I wanted to be among them, not ahead of them, not out front of them, but I wanted to be among them. Well, that was an experience that has impacted my understanding and my approach to ministering in this crisis. First of all, let me tell you that it was a humbling discovery to find who was there. Because I know the images that we have in the mass media are not positive images. Many of the people that we see are not, they're not presented them, they do not present themselves in the professional manner or the professional style that we sometimes think is advisable and acceptable. No, they don't look like us. They don't dress like us. Actually, they don't even talk like us. When I say us, I'm talking about the mainstream culture. And what was surprising to me was how much we had in common. Now, how did I find that out? I found that out because I thought I was going to be moving among strangers. I thought I was, that was my limited perspective. I thought I would be moving around quietly. And since I didn't have on a clerical collar or a pulpit robe, or since I didn't have on a business suit or preacher's clothes, that perhaps I'd be able to move anonymously, only to discover time and time and time again, someone would come up and speak to me. But the most surprising thing was, the most of the people who came in the early days were people who had a connection with this church. The son of a member who's already gone to glory. The son of a member who is active here every time we meet. The daughter of a friend who saw to it that her children came to New Zion during the days when we had our after-school program and summer program for the children. And she said to me, my mother had never had to worry about having fees, because we knew we could go to New Zion and take a part of the program and be able to be accepted without costs. Another one who was baptized here is now one of the leading women in the local Black Lives Matter movement. All of this was to let me know that in the square, I was among my own. And I'll tell you what else has happened to me on several occasions. On one occasion, I had a telephone call early in the morning. One of our members, Sister Baker, called me and said that a friend of hers had called her to tell her I was at the square. I was there at night. and that Anna Pearl Baker did not have to worry about her pastor. She said, my friend said, we got him covered. I really don't even know who it is until today, but I'm glad to be covered. More than once, when a confrontation was going to be expected because of some police militarism, I was cautioned by several of them time and time again. Maybe you ought not stay here tonight. Maybe you ought not stay here with us. There may be some trouble tonight. I didn't say it then, but I'll say it now. A lot of people talk about good trouble, echoing the words of the late Congressman John Lewis. But I'm thankful to God for those who are looking at me. I have this wristband on my left wrist because they came to me one night after the Attorney General had made his announcement and said, Reverend, you put one of these on. And I said, why should I put one of these on? And they said, because we want them to know you are one of us. On another occasion, they brought me a pair of gargles and said, wear these, Reverend. You may have to deal with tear gas. And I said, I may not look like it, but I'm old enough to remember the 1968 riots in Washington, D.C., when I lived a half a block from where they broke out. And I smelled and sniffed it, and it was itching from tear gas for a whole weekend because I lived in that neighborhood. Nevertheless, my brothers and sisters, what I'm trying to say is that sitting where they sat gave me an understanding that I was among my own. They're not some alien group that's come from afar. Real trouble has not come from the Independence Square faithful. And that perhaps is the reason why the movement has lived on, because though the city boarded up the windows downtown, there was still not enough violence to merit that kind of reaction. It was really an overreaction based on fear. Let us look at people differently by getting closer to them to understand more about them. I mean to tell you, it was a humbling discovery, but it was also a learning experience that was shocking. I discovered that our society and its systems have reared a generation through neglect and deprivation. This segment in our community has been segregated by race and plagued by poverty. And it has been by design. So that now, that segment of our community, which was supposed to stay in the West End, get involved with violence and drugs, perhaps be carted off to a jail or prison, or borne to the nearby cemetery, decided that enough is enough. And instead of staying in the back alleys or in the clubs of the West End, they said, no, this cause is just. We are going downtown because we are citizens and we have a right to lift our voices and to make our desires known. So if you never heard us before, hear us now. It's not the 1960s civil rights movement. The clergy are not on the front lines leading the marches. But nevertheless, you hear us now because we have as much right as anyone else to to sound forth a protest against injustice, racism, and inequality. We have raised a generation. Listen to me. When I say we, I'm talking about the church, the school system, and the government has raised this generation that now embarrasses some folks. Because we were satisfied for them to pass from one grade to another without learning anything. We were satisfied for them to be moved from place to place without secure housing. We were satisfied to make it impossible for them to get a job, for make a living, an honest living. We were satisfied to allow drugs to infest our communities. We were satisfied to allow our children fail in school. We were satisfied to stay in our sanctuaries, lifting up holy hands, singing and praising God, and then letting the world and our children and our children's children stay at home and learn the ways of sin. And now we want to be embarrassed and surprised, outraged, because it has come to full exposure. I say to you, there's much work to be done, and that work must be done by all of us, so that there does not need to be just one effort or one program or one project, but all over, in all sectors of our society, in the public sector, in the private sector, if we're going to be saved as a nation, we're going to have to right the wrongs of institutional racism in our society. And I sat where they sat to learn that their cause is just. As I come to think about it, I also think about the convincing approach to changing conditions. What am I speaking about? I'm speaking about the fact that they will not be watered down. They will not be scared off. They will not be bought off. They're willing to stand. I know some people are easily bought off. And I know that others have investments in the community, and they are in a position where they could make a difference because they are among the decision makers. But I declare unto you, brothers and sisters, that if we're going to overcome the problem of racism in our society and injustice in our society, whether it's in the educational system, the court system, in the government system, in the political system, wherever it is, it's going to require somebody that's willing to put their lives on the line. And when you think about it, it's more just for you to offer yourself for the cause that God is engaged in than in your own self-aggrandizement and prosperity. And if you got to die for something, die for the cause that God has appointed. Die, the Master did. He came into this world sent by God. God so loved his only begotten Son that he sent his only begotten Son into the world. He loved the world so much that he was willing to expose Jesus to the evils of the world. But he did it because he loved us. And Jesus, because he loved us, was willing to sacrifice himself and to give himself a ransom for many and for us all. I sat where they sat. I entered into their distress. I entered into their bewilderment. I entered into their silence at times, their shock at times. And then I thought about my days as an undergraduate at Howard University in Washington, D.C. I took an interest in the college choir. And though many of my members who are not here today wouldn't believe this, but I was auditioned, and I passed the audition to sing with the Howard University Choir, the famed Howard University Choir. One of the songs that they taught us was an anthem from the 137th Psalm. It was a song that was written, to me, it sounded like in a minor key. It was not the richness of music that I normally associated with what we call church music. But the song was difficult to learn, made more difficult, of course, because it didn't sound appealing to us. But once we learned it, it became one of our favorites. And then after I learned more about the Bible, I came to realize that this song was sung by the Jews while they were in Babylon, when they went by the river Chebar, and they sang, and they came together in fellowship until finally they discovered that their captivity was going to last longer than the false prophets had promised. And on top of that, their captors taunted them with their music. You know how it is when people like your music but don't like you? They said, "By the waters of Babylon, by the rivers of Babylon, we sat down and wept when we remembered Zion. For there they that carried us away captive required of us a song, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion." They said, "We hung our harps on the willows, because we were not going to provide simple entertainment for our captors." I'm here this day to tell you that because we follow the Lord Jesus Christ, we don't have to give up and hang our harps on the willows. They cried out, "Oh, if I forget thee, O Jerusalem, let my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth." They gave up their singing. They gave up praising God because their faith was attached to one city and one building, the temple. But we are freed from that kind of restrictiveness. We serve one who is a God everywhere. This is my Father's world. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. And therefore, we can praise him anywhere and everywhere. We can praise him whatever's going on in our lives. All we have to do is look to him and see that he knows how much we can bear. He bears our burdens, knows our struggles, answers our prayers, and receives our joyful praise. Praise him. Paul said, praise him. Yes, even in the jailhouse. Praise him among the loud sounding cymbals. Praise him with the instruments of 10 strings. Praise him with the timbrel and the dance. Let everything that have breath praise the Lord. Before you go today, you ought to look around your life and find some one thing that you can be glad about. I don't know how you woke up this morning. You might have woken up, you might have awakened when you were mad. You might have been sad. But you ought to take a little time, look around at all the things that are happening in the world. Find something to be glad about. Oh, count your blessings. Name them one by one. Oh, you will be surprised what the Lord has done, what the Lord is doing, and what he will do. If you trust him, don't doubt him. He'll bring you out, I tell you. Hold on a little while longer. He stayed there 7 days. We stayed there 140 days plus, but that's not the whole story. The whole story is there's a better day that is on its way. There's a better day coming. Oh, yes. And I thank the Lord. It's not far off. It's not far off. It's not far off. You ought to be ready to serve him. Get ready to serve him. If you're already a believer, you ought to get ready to serve him. Don't be satisfied with letting everybody else carry on the ministry of Christ and you just sit back and enjoy receiving the blessings. Draw closer to him. And if you're not a believer, remember that Jesus Christ is the hope of the world. There's no failure in him. And he lives and lives forevermore. The good news is he will receive you just as you are, because he's already paid the price for your sins. You can be washed from your sins, putting your trust in Jesus, involving yourself by taking the step of faith, connecting with the people of God, and beginning the journey that takes us from here to heaven. And we pray this will be your decision today as we continue to meditate on the word of life given to us by the prophet Ezekiel and made applicable to our life in this present time. As the singers come, we give you this moment of meditation to make a decision for the Lord Jesus. Of this service, we want to thank our singers for being here today and our musicians, Brother Guy Dorsey, the drummer, and Brother Keon Hankerson, who is sitting in for our organist, Brother Sean Claiborne, who is away today. We thank God for the ministries of the church that continue to thrive and be blessed. That happens because of the support and faithfulness of members and friends who remember to give as God has blessed and to direct your support here to New Zion, whether it's online at our web address, newzionlouky.com, or whether it's on the post office system, post office box 11067, Louisville, Kentucky, zip code 40251. We're looking forward to another Thursday for our 20th COVID-19 free food drive-through, which begins at 1 o'clock, and as long as supplies last, we save them through 3 o'clock. But here recently, we've had more people coming than before, and we thank God for the opportunity to serve the families of our community. We're moving forward to several other events. I mentioned earlier the 48th Pastor's Anniversary celebration next Sunday, October the 25th, and that will be a time when we celebrate in a different way. Actually, we will be doing this service at 12 noon, and we look forward to having some guests with us. And our preacher is one of my co-workers at the Square, and one of our singers, Minister Stachel Bussey, who is not only a singer but an activist in our community. As a matter of fact, she's with a group of Louisvillians in a demonstration this weekend in New York City. And next Sunday, she'll be here preaching. A recent graduate of the Presbyterian Theological Seminary here in Louisville. And we ask your prayers for that service at 12 noon on the Facebook Live hookup. We also are looking forward to the Halloween of October 31st. And there's been a request gone out for candies. Who are members of New Zion have that information, and we ask you to bring it to the church, whatever you have, and we might prepare it for something similar to our food drive-through. We will not have the normal trunk-or-treat or Halloween party, but we do want to do something for our young people, the young children and kids that are part of this neighborhood. And so we are asking you to bring it this week, and then we'll get it ready for next Saturday evening from 5 to 7 o'clock. We thank the Lord for those of you who have already gone to the polls or have mailed in your ballots. I have my vote wristband on today from having already cast my vote. And so I want to appeal to you to do that. And we thank God for every agency, organization, church, and otherwise helping our people get to the polls. Think about it as even being more important because of the people who are not able to vote due to the vital statistics brought on by COVID-19. And so our vote becomes even more important. And we thank you very much for supporting those who have registered to vote. We want to encourage you to go out to any of the numerous places that are available from now until Election Day. And then on Election Day, the number of places that will be posted. And we'll be sharing those through our church communications. But we praise God for these efforts. And we ask that you would pray for our nation as we go forward into this season. On our prayer list today, we want to continue praying for Sister Jamela Mosey. She's been in the hospital, as has Sister Patricia Marshall. And we're praying for the family of the late Brother Harry Dick Jones. His services were held on yesterday, and we are praying for his family. And all the others whose names are on our continuing prayer list, we think about you, we pray about you, and we join with you wherever and in whatever ways possible. And so we thank God for this day. And we pray that God will bless you as you go out. And even if you're not going out, if you extend yourself to others while at home, God will bless your efforts to do much good. Our Father and our God, again, we thank you for this day. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that you blessed us to be alive and to be able to share with one another on whatever side of the camera we find ourselves. We thank you for appointing us a place where we can be a part of the fellowship of believers. And we pray, oh God, that someone who walks in darkness also begins to see the light, the saving light of Christ. And grant, O God, that they will know that your grace is sufficient for each life and every life. That by grace we are saved through faith, and that not of ourselves, but it is the gift of God. Be with those, O Father, who are going through difficult days because of physical illness, who are dealing with mental anguish, economic stress, or whatever other challenges are being faced. We know you are God enough to answer prayer and to answer every prayer. You are God enough to handle every situation. And you are God enough to work a miracle even in times like these. And so, Lord, we thank you today. We ask your blessings upon those who are trusting you to lead them step by step along life's highway. Hear our prayers. Incline your ear unto us and grant us your peace. We ask in the wonderful name of the Lord Jesus Christ, now and forever. Amen.